just because Islam tells you that you should not kill any children, whether it be male or female. Will you call these rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Islam not only prohibits killing of infant children, it also prohibits and it rebukes you on rejoicing on the birth of a male child and you getting saddened on the news of a female child. If you read Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 58 and 59, it tells you that when news is brought to one of them of a birth of a female child, his face darkens and he's filled with inward grief. He hides himself in shame from his people because of the news he has received. Should he let her live in suffering or should he bury her in dust? Ah, what an evil choice they have. Quran not only prohibits female infanticide, it rebukes at the thought of you rejoicing at the birth of a male child and getting saddened at the birth of a female child. In Islam, a daughter should be brought up correctly. And according to a hadith in Ahmad, the Prophet may peace be upon him, he said, anyone who brings up two daughters properly, they will be like this to me on the day of judgment. Means will be very close to me on the day of judgment. And there's another hadith which says that anyone who upbrings two daughters properly and takes good care and brings them up with love and affection, they will enter paradise. In Islam, there should be no partiality in upbringing of the daughters of the son. According to a hadith of our beloved Prophet, it said that in the presence of the Prophet, once a man kissed his son and placed him on his lap, but did not do the same to his daughter. The Prophet immediately objected and said that you are unjust. You should have even kissed your daughter and placed her on the other lap. Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he did not only speak about justice, he also practiced it. Let's analyze the rights of a wife in Islam. All the previous civilizations, they have considered the woman to be an instrument of the devil. The Quran refers to the woman as Mahsana, that is a fortress against the devil. And if a woman who's good marries a man, she prevents him from going on the wrong path and keeps him on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, that's the correct path. There's a hadith in which Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he said that there is no monasticism in Islam. And again, according to Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, chapter number 3, hadith number 4, it says that the Prophet ordained the young men, all those who have the means to marry, they should marry, for it will help them to lower the gaze and guard their modesty. There is another hadith related by Anas, in which the Prophet said, anyone who marries completes half his deen. Once somebody asked me that, does it imply that if I marry twice, I'll be completing my full deen? The person misunderstood the message of the Prophet. When the Prophet said that when you marry, you complete half your deen, it means that when you marry, it shields you from promiscuity. It shields you from fornication. It shields you from homosexuality, which lead to half the sin in this world. Only when you marry do you have opportunity to become a husband or a wife. Only when you marry do you have opportunity to become a father or a mother. And the duties of the mother and the father and that of a husband and wife are very important in Islam. So it makes no difference whether a man marries once, twice, or thrice, or four times, he yet completes only half his deen. The Quran says that we have put love into the hearts of the husband and wife. If you read Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 21, it says that, and amongst our signs, we have created for you mates or companions, so that you may dwell in them in tranquility. And we have put love and mercy between your hearts. According to Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 21, marriage is considered as a misakh, a sacred agreement, a sacred contract. According to Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 19, it says, you are prohibited to inherit women against their will. Means, to marry, the permission of both the parties are required. It's compulsory that the man and woman both should agree to marry. No one, not even the father, can force their daughter to marry against her wishes. There's a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, chapter number 43, hadith number 69, which says that a lady, she was forced by her father to marry against her wishes, and she went to the Prophet, and the Prophet invalidated the marriage. And the hadith in Ibn Hanbal, hadith number 2469, it says that a daughter was forced by a father to get married, and when the daughter approached the Prophet said, you can either continue, or if you wish, you can invalidate the marriage. That means the consent of both the male and the female is required. In Islam, a woman is considered as a homemaker. She is not considered as a housewife because she is not married to the house. Many people use terminologies without understanding what it means. Housewife means you're the wife of the house. So I believe from now onwards, the sisters would prefer calling themselves homemakers than housewives if they occupied more in the home. In Islam, a woman, she is not married to a master that she should be treated like a slave. She is married to its equal. And there's a hadith which says in Ibn Hanbal, hadith number 7396, it says that the most perfect of the believers are those that are best in character and behavior, and those that are best to their family and their wives. Islam gives equal rights to the man and woman. And as mentioned by the Honorable Justice M.M. Qazi, that Quran clearly mentions that men and women, husband and wife, have equal rights in all aspects except leadership in the family. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 228. It says that the woman has been given rights similar to as against them on equitable terms, but the men have a degree higher. And I perfectly agree with Justice M.M. Qazi when he said that most of the Muslims have misunderstood this verse when it says a man have a degree higher. As I said, we should analyze the Quran as a whole. And it's mentioned in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 34, which says, Al-Rijalu Qawwamuna ala Nisa, that the men are the protectors and maintainers of the women. For